to all our learners, all our viewers, welcome to the lecture on peacekeeping. I am Dr. Amna. I teach political science at Shyama Prasad Mukherjee College for Women, University of Delhi. Dear learners, as we take the learning on peacekeeping, which is a very essential concept today, looking into account contemporary world issues. Today, we'll be looking at aspects of peacekeeping, the other details involved, peacemaking, the other aspects involved in peacemaking, peace building, what are the conditions for it, looking at the role of United Nations herein, and then trying to situate it within the realm of global conflicts. So the lecture today will attempt to explain the significance of peacekeeping, and we will be also looking at various related realms to present insights into how United Nations peacekeeping operations and activities have not only increased, grown in size, but it has also become increasingly complex and multidimensional. At the outset, let us understand, peacekeeping is a technique designed to preserve the peace, however fragile, where fighting has been halted, and to assist in implementing agreements achieved by peacemakers. Over the years, peacemaking has evolved from a primarily military model of observing ceasefires and separation of forces after interstate wars to incorporate a complex model of many elements, military, police, civilian, working together to help lay the foundations for sustainable peace. Peace enforcement. Yes, so as we take the discussion forward, let us now understand the ambit of peace enforcement. Peace enforcement involves the application with the authorization of the Security Council of a range of coercive measures, including use of military force. Such actions are authorized to restore international peace and security in situations where Security Council has determined the existence of a threat to the peace, breach of the peace, or act of aggression. The Security Council may utilize, wherever appropriate, regional organizations and agencies for enforcement action under its authority. Then, when you take the discussion forwards, therefore we get the picture that peace building, the other aspect, this involves a range of measures targeted to reduce the risk of lapsing or relapsing into conflict by strengthening national capacities at all levels for conflict management and to lay the foundations for sustainable peace and development. Peace building, therefore, is a complex, long-term process of creating the necessary conditions for sustainable peace. It works by addressing deep-rooted structural causes of violent conflicts in a comprehensive manner. Peace-building measures address core issues that affect the functioning of society and the state and seek to enhance the capacity of the state to effectively and legitimately carry out its core functions. Then another related aspect is that of conflict prevention. Conflict prevention involves the application of a structural diplomatic measure to keep intrastate or interstate tensions and disputes from escalating into violent conflict. Ideally, it should be built on structured early warning, information gathering, and a careful analysis of the factors driving the conflict. peacemaking generally includes measures to address conflicts in progress and usually involves diplomatic action to bring hostile parties to a negotiated agreement. So therefore, peacekeeping is an effective tool at the hands for the United Nations to assist host countries navigate the difficult path from conflict to peace. The Charter of the United Nations was signed in San Francisco on 26 June 1945, and this charter is the foundation document for all United Nations work. The United Nations was established to save succeeding generations from the scourge of the war, and one of its main purposes was to maintain international peace and security. Peacekeeping, although then we can say not explicitly provided for in the Charter of United Nations, but it has evolved into one of the main tools used by United Nations to achieve this purpose. So therefore, when we look at the benefits of peacekeeping, legitimacy, burden sharing, ability to deploy and sustain troops, provide help to people around the globe, integrating them with civilian peacemakers and peacekeepers to advance multi-dimensional mandates. UN peacekeeping is guided by three basic principles. Let us have a look at them. First, consent of the parties. Second, impartiality. Third, non-use of force except in self-defense and defense of the mandate. Then another related feature that we must look into account while analyzing peacemaking is that it is a flexible process, looking at the changes in scenario and it changes in the context of global conflicts and global politics. Today, peacekeeping is multidimensional. It facilitates the political process, protects civilians, assists in disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration of former combatants, supports the organization of elections, project and promote human rights, and assist in resolving the rule of law. We must read more about it at the web source peacekeeping.un.org. Now, when we take the discussion forward, the issue of when really comes into picture. That is, when was the time when peacekeeping was actually deployed? So, United Nations peacekeeping forces were employed by the world organizations to maintain or re-establish peace in an area of armed conflict. The UN may engage in conflicts between states as well as in struggles within states. This also gives insights that it may also prepare the ground for a settlement of issues that have provoked armed conflict, or it may also contribute to reducing the level of conflict. When both parties to a conflict accept their presence, or to avoid having a conflict escalate, or to have a struggle called off. So there are the various areas and dimensions wherein peacekeeping may be employed. Peacekeeping forces are subordinate to the leadership of United Nations. They are deployed as a consequence of Security Council decision. However, one may also take into account that on occasion, the initiative that has been taken by General Assembly, operation controls in that case belongs to the Secretary General and the Secretariat. Two kinds of peacekeeping operations. First is the unarmed observer groups. They are allowed to employ their weapons for self-defense, concerned with gathering information to the UN about actual conditions prevailing in the area. An example here, as to whether both parties adhere to an armistice agreement. Another type of peacekeeping for operation, light armed military forces. Military forces are entrusted with more extended tasks such as keeping the parties to a conflict apart and maintaining order in an area. The first UN peacekeeping mission was established in May 1948 when UN Security Council authorized the deployment of a small number of UN military observers to the Middle East to form United Nations Truce Supervision Organization to monitor the armistice agreement between Israel and its Arab neighbors. The UN first took on the task of sending observers to monitor the armistice between Israel and Arab states, therefore, in 1948. Observer group was resumed after the wars of 1956, 1967 and 1973. Another force was established after the war between Egypt and Israel in 1967 to monitor the armistice agreement between the parties. In 1974, a smaller UN force was set up on the Golan Heights to maintain the boundary line between Syrian and Israeli forces. The UN played an important role also during the struggles that erupted when the Belgian colony of Congo achieved independence in 1960. So therefore, all these inputs that we are providing to you from Nobelprize.org, one must reflect on them in order to understand how and where peacekeeping forces have functioned. Maintaining the peacekeeping force, therefore, was also established on Cyprus on account of the civil war that broke between the Greek and Turkish populations of the island. UN peacekeeping forces that operated in Sierra Leone from 1999 to 2005, they created to implement a peace agreement after the country's devastating civil war. To determine whether the peacekeeping operations have succeeded or not, and an important question that is, the identification of a conceptual framework for their evaluation is necessary. And we have to also take into account that numerous conceptual, organizational and conflict specific variables on which both the peacekeeping mission and the peacekeepers have little control that directly impact the outcome of peacekeeping operations. The UN peacekeeping operations can be deployed only, we all know, after the approval of the UN Security Council. The budget for the operation is approved by the United Nations General Assembly once the Council adopts the resolution for its deployment. Before and after its employment, there are three interrelated principles of peacekeeping, that is consent, impartiality and use of force in self-defense. And we also know that no direct reference to principles of the peacekeeping is there in the UN Charter. So therefore, when we are trying to understand the idea of peacekeeping, one must also look into account certain other related issues, that is lack of understanding of the peacekeeping principles and the mandate, the issue of absence of a comprehensive and inclusive peace agreement, the issue of lack of continued support at times from the Security Council and inadequate budgetary support also are issues that often impact the working of peacekeeping operations. Over the past 60 years, the United Nations peacekeeping has evolved into one of the main tools used by international community to manage complex crises that pose a threat to international peace and security. Since the beginning of the new millennium, the number of military, police and civilian personnel deployed in United Nations peacekeeping operations around the world has reached unprecedented levels. Not only has United Nations peacekeeping grown in size, but it has become increasingly complex. Beyond simply monitoring ceasefires, today's multidimensional peacekeeping operations are called to facilitate the political process through the promotion of national dialogue and reconciliation, protect civilians, assist in disarmaments, demobilization, amongst others. And these are some of the very important words coming forward from a very interesting internal document of the United Nations. And these words have been presented to us by G. Maria Guanseo. And this brings us to an important aspect, that is peacekeeping and human rights. See, international human rights law is an integral part of the normative framework for United Nations peacekeeping operations. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which sets the cornerstone of international human rights standards, emphasizes that human rights and fundamental freedoms are universal and therefore to be guaranteed to everyone. Now, in this realm, United Nations peacekeeping operations should be therefore conducted in light of full respect of human rights and should seek to advance human rights through the implementation of their mandates. Another interesting correlation is that between peacekeeping and international humanitarian law. International humanitarian law is designed to protect people who do not participate or no longer are participating in the hostilities, and it maintains the fundamental rights of civilians, victims, non-combatants in an armed conflict. It is relevant to United Nations peacekeeping operations because those missions are often deployed into post-conflict environments where violence may be ongoing or conflict could reignite. The traditional United Nations peacekeeping operations, when we look at, the traditional ones were constructed with the consent of parties to a conflict, usually the states, in which blue helmets monitor a truce between warring states where mediators seek a political solution to the underlying conflict. However, with the change of context, with the end of the Cold War, the strategic context for United Nations peacekeeping has also changed dramatically, and the Security Council began to work more actively to promote containment and peaceful resolution of regional conflicts. With the end of the Cold War also coincided a general decline in incidence of conflict around the world. Internal armed conflicts today, if we look at, constitute the vast majority of today's war issues. So therefore, transformation of the international environment has given rise to a new generation of multidimensional United Nations peacekeeping operations. These operations are typically deployed in dangerous aftermath of a violent internal conflict and may deploy a mix of military, police, civilian capabilities to support the implementation of a comprehensive peace agreement. Some multidimensional United Nations peacekeeping operations have been deployed following a request from the national authorities to suggest the transition to legitimized government in the absence of a formal peace agreement. In exceptional circumstances, the Security Council has also authorized multidimensional United Nations peacekeeping operations to temporarily assume legislative and administrative functions of the state. Multidimensional United Nations peacekeeping operations deployed in the aftermath of an internal conflict also face a particularly challenging environment. Then, within this broader context, the core functions of a multidimensional United Nations peacekeeping operations, therefore, are to create a secure and stable environment while strengthening the state's ability to provide security, facilitate the political process by providing dialogue and reconciliation and supporting the establishment of legitimate and effective institutions of government, provide a framework for ensuring that all United Nations and other international actors pursue the activities at the country level in a coherent manner. Then what makes for sustainable peace? Another important question that comes forward is, that is restoring the state's ability to provide security and maintain public order, strengthening the rule of law and respect for human rights, supporting the emergence of legitimate political institutions and participatory processes, providing social and economic recovery and development, including the safe return or resettlement of internally displaced persons or refugees uprooted by conflict. Then another aspect of critical peace building activities. They could be disarmament, demobilization, reintegration, mine action, security sector reform, and other rule of law related activities, electoral assistance, protection and promotion of human rights, support to the restoration and extension of state authority. Now, information and communication are very crucial for peacekeeping operations because effective communications and outreach enhance the mission's ability to achieve its mandate. It increases confidence in peace processes, it builds on trust amongst the parties, helps counter the negative effect of hostile and another kind of irresponsible statements. The international legitimacy of United Nations peacekeeping operations is very essential to understand because it is derived from the fact that it is established after obtaining a mandate from the United Nations Security Council, which has the primary responsibility for the maintenance of international peace and security. The uniquely broad representation of member states who contribute personnel and funding to the United Nations operations further strengthen their international legitimacy. The manner in which United Nations peacekeeping operations conclude itself also may have a profound impact on the perceived legitimacy on the ground. The firmness and the fairness with which a United Nations peacekeeping operation exercises its mandate, the circumscription within which uses force are also essential. So the discipline it imposes upon its personnel, the respect it shows to the local customs, institutions and laws, the decency with which it treats the local people, all have a direct impact on the perceptions of its legitimacy. Then another important aspect is that of integration, that is the process through which United Nations system seeks to maximize its contribution towards countries emerging from conflict by engaging in different capabilities in a coherent, supportive manner. Another aspect is that of an integrated mission, that is a strategic partnership between a multidimensional UN peacekeeping operations and the UNCTs based on a shared vision amongst all United Nations actors as for a strategic objective of the United Nations presence at the country level. Then another aspect is that of a preventive diplomacy. By that we understand diplomatic efforts to avert disputes arising between parties from escalating into conflict. Another aspect is that of peacemaking action, that is to bring hostile parties to an agreement. Another term that we must keep into account, peace operations, that is field operations that are deployed to prevent, manage and to resolve violent conflict or to reduce the risk of their recurrence. Peace enforcement, that is a collective action undertaken with the authorization of United Nations Security Council to maintain or restore international peace and security in situations where Security Council has determined the existence of a threat to the peace, breach of the peace or act of aggressions. Some of the spoilers could be individuals or groups that may profit from the spread or continuation of violence or have an interest to disrupt a resolution of conflict in a given setting. Transition is an important aspect to understand, that is handover of responsibilities from a non-United Nations led peace operations to United Nations peace operations or from latter to other United Nations or non-United Nations actors upon successful completion of its mandate. Now, dear learners, as we conclude our lecture, let's have a look at certain very important reference that you may use as resource base for your further studies. A very important document from which we dwelt a lot in our learning today is United Nations Peacekeeping Operations Principles and Guidelines. This is from United Nations Department of Peacekeeping Operations, Department of Field Support. So, dear learners, this was the lecture today on peacekeeping. We hope you all gained some significant insight into the realm of peacekeeping, peacemaking, peace building, and the most important crucial role that it is playing in the contemporary scenario from the perspective of complexity, multidimensionality in the realm of global conflicts. Thank you very much, listeners, for being with us.